Chairpersons and friends, I'm going to describe for you two very interesting cases. Both of them illustrate a very important point that you can be a super specialist, but you have to continue to be a good internist if you want to be good in practice. So this is the point I'll illustrate. I'll describe the two cases. Time permitting, I may describe five very quick nuggets about insulin therapy. How do you adjust in given situation? So let's proceed. Case one. This is a patient with type 2 diabetes and urinary tract infection, but somewhat rare situation that we encountered, which some of us diagnose on phone when the resident actually phones you, but I'd like to see whether you all can judge that quickly. So this is story of a 58-year-old female patient, a known case of type 2 diabetes for 18 years duration, hypertension for last 8 years, hypothyroidism for 6 years, admitted to Jaslok Hospital in view of abdominal pain, fever, loose motion and decreased urine output for the past 3 days. She also had burning micturition for the past 5 days in addition to this, and abdominal pain was colic in nature and localized to the left hypochondriac region. Left hypochondriac region. I must tell you that left hypochondriac region also is anterior renal angle. We all think of posterior renal angle, but think of anterior renal angle. Patient had poor glycemic control, blood sugars being in the range of 250, 350 all the time. Patient had a history of diabetic neuropathy and a bad peripheral vascular disease, which required bilateral limb amputation. I must tell you that she was not my patient earlier. Now we don't see one amputation except some toes. For the last 10 years, I have not had one amputation below knee even. So anyway, this was the example of a badly managed patient and bad peripheral vascular disease, which sometimes is difficult to manage. She had retinopathy also with laser treatment in the past. So a diagnosis of type 2 diabetes with retinopathy, neuropathy, peripheral vascular disease, and urinary tract infection was made. Patient was given insulin with IV analgesics and IV fluids. She was put on tablet Urepa, which is, you know, Repaglanide, because the creatinine was borderline, so we gave Repaglanide. Pre-meal, tablet Tragenta, 5 mg daily, and Epidry insulin 3 times a day. So this was the regime given. Her white cell count was 16,000 or more, creatinine was 1.6, EGFR was 70 ml per minute. Sodium was slightly low, potassium slightly high, uric acid high, blood sugar high, and serum albumin was a bit low, 3.3. She was further evaluated for abdominal pain with ultrasound, which revealed left hydronephrosis with dilated proximal ureter, urinary bladder debris, gallbladder calculi, and fatty changes in the liver. CT abdomen and pelvis were done very carefully because creatinine was raised, which showed left renomegaly with marked surrounding fat stranding and facial thickening suggestive of pyelonephritis. This indicates perinephric infection. These are typical findings of perinephric infection on a CT scan. PET CT was done, which showed poorly functioning left kidney. Urine culture was done, which grew Klebsiella pneumonia. So what would be the diagnosis? Anybody wants to venture? Of course, the urinary tract infection. Anything further you can think of? Pardon me? Pyelonephritis, yes, of course. Anything else? Colicky pain. Of course, calculi are always possible, urinary calculi. But what else is typical to diabetes? Pyelonephritis, but don't get colicky pain. Anyone? Okay. Anyway.
Papillary necrosis.
Ketoacidosis. She wasn't in ketoacidosis.
What? Papillary necrosis.
Probably?
Papillary necrosis.
Who is the?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the correct diagnosis. This is what I made on phone when my resident phoned me that the urinary tract infection, the bad colicky pain. I told it would be papillary necrosis. Let's call the urologist quickly. Okay. Clinically, patient was febrile, toxic, severely tender left kidney, diagnosis of left obstructed kidney with pyelonephritis made. She was referred to urologist. The ultrasound was not as good to picture, so I drew this schematic. You can see there obstruction in the junction of upper one-third and lower two-third of the left ureter, and And most interestingly, with care, the ultrasonographer could find out some floating papilla in the kidney, floating papilla. And the obstruction was also one papilla, so this urologist did the ureteroscopy under local anesthesia because she was very ill. So we have some ace urologist. Just look, we got all kind of people who can do procedures for you in very moribund people. So with ureteroscope, finding included thick purulent plus in the bladder, which was washed out, purulent efflux from left ureteral orifice, large impacted papilla was found in that site of obstruction, which was removed with forceps, gush of pus came through, and then she was stented. The general condition improved, and then we were worried whether we should preserve this kidney or not. So we did the isotopic scan to see the differential function of the kidney, and we found the kidney was still functioning in spite of four sloughed papilla. Four papilla had sloughed, which were recovered. So in spite of that, it was working. So we did not do nephrectomy. We kept the kidney inside. Most interesting aspect, another interesting aspect, of course, she was given antibiotics and treated, so I'll pass this on rapidly. Now, another interesting aspect was that this patient had persistent hyperkalemia. Now, this is very interesting. Sometimes we dismiss it. With some kidney problem, hyperkalemia is common. But diabetics sometimes can have hyperkalemia without renal involvement. This is important. This is a very interesting problem. And every year we diagnose a few patients, diabetics with hyporenemic hypoaldosteronism. Very well described in the books, not often diagnosed, but we do a couple of them every year. Hyporenemic hypoaldosteronism. Here the renin and aldosterone levels both are on the low normal side, you see. And remember that these people, you see, the hyperkalemia responds to fludrocortisone. So extra dose of mineralocorticoid, aldosterone is not there. They also have some aldosterone resistance as well. So we exhibited fludrocortisone in small doses, and that really controlled the hyperkalemia very well. And you'll see here the mechanism of this is the juxtaglomerular apparatus from which you see the renin is secreted. That is dependent upon several factors, including, of course, the macula densa cells, including the flow in there in the efferent vessels, including the blood volume, all those dependent on that. And in diabetics, many of these factors are adverse, so that the hyporeninemia, which leads to hypoaldosteronism, because your renin has to be converted to aldosterone, to angiotensin 1, angiotensin 2, and that stimulates the secretion of aldosterone. So it's another interesting condition occurring in diabetics, which you should be familiar with. I quickly go to case 2, and that is a diabetic with severe muscle weakness, type 2 diabetic who came to us with severe muscle weakness. Happened to be a colleague of ours at Joslo, quite elderly, 74-year-old man with chief complaints of pyrexia, which is dry cough and post-nasal discharge, burning, micturition, severe generalized malaise for the last 1 week. He complained of severe prostration and near total paresis of both lower limbs. He could not get up, he could not stand up. In the year 2006, he was found to have abnormal thyroid function due to autoimmune thyroiditis, and started on ThyroNorm and with monitoring of thyroid hormones and dose adjustments periodically. He also had an autoimmune hepatitis with anti-nuclear antibody positivity. So he had two autoimmune disorders, took corticosteroids for 2 years for this problem, 2 years corticosteroid, starting with 40 milligram prednisolone and gradual tapering of the dose. In the year 2012, he had spinal canal stenosis with a foot drop. On further investigations, MRI scan spine revealed tuberculosis of spine. He was put on anti-cox treatment. In the year 2014, he had recrudescence of spinal disease and was again put on corticosteroids. We thought there was some compression because of this cox lesion there, so which was tapered slowly to 10 milligram followed by 5 milligram as maintenance dose. This is being continued currently with AKT and steroids, was continued for 2 years from 2013 to 15, that is for more than a 2-year period. He had an episode of pancreatitis in the year 2004. Thereafter, diabetes was detected in the year 2006. He was started on metformin with dose adjustment as per the glycemic level, later alpha glucosidase inhibitor, and had good to control postprandial blood glucose. His recent A1C was 6%. He gave history of hypoglycemic attacks with blood sugar levels of 30 milligram with unconsciousness, disorientation, and a convulsion recently. Of course, not very potent anti-hypoglycemic drugs, mind you, only metformin and alpha-glucosidase inhibitor, and he still had hypoglycemia. He was diagnosed as having deviated nasal septum in childhood and is on medical management since then. Sinus pus was drained 5 to 6 years ago. He underwent percutaneous transluminal coronary angioplasty in USA in 1986, coronary artery bypass grafting in 92, and since then he's on coronary dilators and platelet inhibitors. In the family, one brother had diabetes. So all complications that a diabetic has, can you see? We handle a lot of complicated problems at the Just Look, frankly. See, not many diabetologists practice acute medicine, but that's the difference between those who continue to practice whole internal medicine and those who only practice glycemic control. I call them sugar adjusters and not diabetologists. Sorry to make that comment, you know. Patient was febrile with temperature of 100 degrees, hemodynamically stable, no evidence of conjunctivitis. Because we thought there is some viral, post-viral weakness of both lower limbs, you know. So we went through that, and blood pressure 140/88, and then the neurologically severe weakness of all limbs, more in the lower limbs. So generalized severe asthenia, unable to get up. We called a neurologist who was nonplussed, you see, because he didn't know what was happening, you see. Patient was put on some antibiotics. Nerve conduction was done, which showed generalized sensory neuropathy with minimal motor involvement of peripheral nerves, mainly axonal type. So it's a typical diabetic neuropathy, which is more axonal than demyelinating, and length-dependent peripheral neuropathy. You see, additionally, they detected a root lesion and chronic severe left, you see, root lesion. He was seen by a neurophysician who diagnosed diabetic sensory motor neuropathy with superadded lumbar radicular involvement, some proximal lesion like radicular involvement. The cause of acute profound weakness of both limbs was obscure. You see, the neurologist couldn't nail down what was going on, why this person couldn't get up, you see, and couldn't move at all. Electrolytes were normal, potassium 3.9, magnesium was normal. It's a low normal, but it was not hypomagnesemia, because many of you must be thinking of that as a cause of sudden weakness in the diabetic. Remember that recovering diabetic ketoacidosis, I have seen severe hypomagnesemia with severe muscle pain and patient unable to move. So this is one possibility, so we thought of that. So fever continued, chest x-ray was normal, cardiac evaluation was done, 2D echo showed a kinetic inferior posterior wall and 45% ejection fraction. You see, continue his medication prescribed by cardiologist. Statin dose was reduced. We thought by chance it is statin myopathy, but CPK was normal, by the way. Patient was referred to a general internist for fever, blood and urine cultures were advised, which showed no growth. No significant abnormalities were seen in hematological parameter. Fundus did not show retinopathy. On day three, a therapeutic intervention. So we were called, because he was our patient for a long time with diabetes. So we were called to look after his diabetes and, of course, give some opinion about the weakness. So we suggested a therapeutic intervention, which made him okay in 2 hours' time. He started walking in 2 hours' time. So what do you think this was? First time it was guessed very correctly by one of you. So. Electrolyte imbalance.
We would like to know the CT findings.
Magnesemia is possible, but...
CT brain.
Pardon me?
CT brain.
What is it?
Has the patient undergone CT of brain?
Brain CT scan.
Why did you want to do brain scan?
To rule out a central lesion.
lesions would be in the brain because of weakness of both lower limbs.
Yes.
Generalized weakness with severe weakness of lower limbs. Pardon me? Addisons. Due to what? Addisons. You are not very far off. You are coming close to
patient
diagnosis.
Patient is already on steroids.
You are coming close to diagnosis. Yes? Absolutely. Very good. Okay, here you are. Sorry, where are we? Yeah, we leave out this. Sorry, are we going back? This is the additional diagnosis now. His serum cortisol was 3 microgram per DL at 8 a.m. He was in HPA axis insufficiency. That's all there was. We diagnosed that because we knew his steroid ingestion for several years. So we just injected hydrocortisone and he started walking and of course subsequently continued his doses. Of course, you know very well that prednisolone more than 5 milligram a day used for more than 3 weeks is a HPA axis insufficiency suspect and includes locally active steroids, by the way. I have seen this happening with lot of corticosteroid containing creams, by the way. So do remember that, because that you may not diagnose. So you confirm by doing a serum cortisol at 8 a.m. any time of the day, if the person is under stress, then it should be more than 20, that is completely competent HPA axis. Between 8 to 10 is doubtful, and certainly very low, like 3, is definitely HPA axis insufficiency. You must treat with steroids, you see. And slowly over the next 6 to 12 months, you are supposed to taper steroids, keep checking cortisol. This patient must carry an alert card, by the way, you see. So prevention is use minimum effective corticosteroid and alternate day corticosteroids. I treat lot of, you see, autoimmune diseases, thyroid autoimmune diseases, sometimes we treat, and many other we treat to grouse, ophthalmopathy, very bad one. But I have never used steroids daily. This is endocrinologist's prescription. I have seen my best neurology colleagues and all using corticosteroids daily. Well, it is extremely well written. There were books that alternate day corticosteroid is the best way to do it. So anyway, just to emphasize that, I've got 7 minutes left, so I'll discuss very quick 5 small clinical problems for you. That is diabetology, sugar adjusters. Sugar adjusters time, you see. So 21-year-old type 1 diabetic, A1C 7.5, BMI 22, creatinine 0.9, on human regular insulin 3 times a day pre-meal and glargine at bedtime. Classical basal bolus prescription. He has nocturnal hypoglycemia 2 to 3 times per week. Very frequent nocturnal hypo. Nocturnal hypo is the most unpleasant hypo. You see, time at ungodly hour, help is not available, and the counter-regulatory mechanisms are not working properly in the reclining position at night. So patients really go into a bad episode of hypoglycemia. So what is the best correction? Reduce glargine-induced insulin, reduce pre-dinner regular insulin, substitute pre-dinner insulin by lispro insulin and shift glargine to morning time, or substitute pre-dinner insulin by glulysine insulin. What is the best action? How many for A? Nobody for A. How many for B? Some. C? Okay. D? Yeah, C is best. See, for normally we do not encourage use of analogs because there are 2 to 3 times the cost. Of course, in our country, frankly, we use more analogs than what we should. But anyway, but this is a situation where analog is worthwhile because human regular has quite long action. So it will produce bad. And then remember that normally we give glargine at night, but now there is a case made for giving glargine in the morning, especially in patients who suffer from nocturnal hypo. Glargine should not be at night, it should be in the morning. Okay, next one. 60-year-old type 2 diabetic, see, BMI 24, A1C is quite okay, EGFR more than 60, You see, on insulin regime of human regular 8, 6 and 8 before meals, and with metformin 500 milligram plus glycoside 80 milligram TDS. How many of you use sulfonylurea and ureas for sensitizing type 2 diabetics? Because this was patient on insulin, and we're still giving oral agent metformin, fine. Do you give sulfonylurea for sensitizing? Yeah, it's the excellent sensitizer, excellent sensitizer. In fact, the first sensitizer described in insulin resistance was sulfonylurea. But most of you were not even in medical college or not born also when these papers came, you know. These papers came 30 years ago. And not one or two, there must be about 50 papers on sulfonylurea sensitizing. Only thing is when you use glycoside, and glycoside is the best to use that, so we do that, but use in small doses. And don't use long-acting glycoside, and don't use glimepiride. I use only glycoside, 20 milligram three times a day to sensitize. It works beautifully and without much hypo. Anyway, that's giving you some clues, you know, how to go about it. So what is the best action required, you know? Very high 2 hour postprandial sugar after every meal. So it is a PP hyperglycemia, very bad postprandial hyperglycemia. So would you stop insulin? Would you switch to rapid insulin analog and stop glycoside? Will you give only metformin as sensitizer, or would you stop OHA completely? Okay. Recurrent hypoglycemia, pre-meal, and bad postprandial hyperglycemia. Hypo-hyper, combination of both. See? Yes? A? Anybody for A? Anybody for B? Yeah, B, good number. Yeah, C? Only metformin, not glycoside. D? Nobody? Yeah, B is fine. Rapid acting analog will prevent the interprandial hypoglycemia because the action is very short. So you will, and it takes care of prandial hyperglycemia. See? So you do that. So this is the correct thing to do. 65-year-old type 2 diabetic, 22-year duration on metformin, glycoside, and a good basal bolus insulin therapy. The total insulin dose is higher, 130 units. A1C 9.5, creatinine 1.9, BMI 22, EGFR 45. Which insulin sensitizer will you use? You know, still A1C 9.5. 4 shots of insulin a day. So you still have to act and do something. So obviously increasing insulin, is that the answer? 130 units a day, nicely divided into basal bolus. You think should you increase insulin? No, it's useless. So it should be a sensitizer. So which sensitizer? Pioglitazone, DPP-4 like linagliptin maybe, because there is renal failure, so you want to feel safe with whatever doses. SGLT2 inhibitor, empagliflozin plus lina or glimepiride 2 milligram. C, SGLT2 inhibitor and empagliflozin. B, lina alone. Yes, lina alone, if it works, yes, will be good. Yeah, it will be good. You see, but if it doesn't work, can you give empa also? EGFR is 45. Yeah, you can. You see, so I think that will be a good sensitizer here. 1 minute, yeah, so we can do one more. 25-year-old female, type 1, BMI 29, planning to initiate a pregnancy. She is on basal bolus plan of glulicin 3 times a day and glargine at 10 p.m., A1C 8.5. Which is the best regime? In pregnancy, which is the best regime, frankly? Human atrapid 3 times a day and NPH twice a day. Optimized current insulin therapy only, glulicin 3 times and Levimer bedtime, and aspart insulin 3 times, Levimer plus metformin 1 gram daily. Which is the best regime? A? How many for A? How many for B? B. How many for C? D? Yeah, I think D is good. aspart is okay in pregnancy, Levimer is okay in pregnancy, and metformin is okay. The BMI is 29, is a bit overweight pregnant, and obesity is a risk for the fetus, you know, and more weight gain in pregnancy, another risk. So you rather use metformin to sensitize so you don't end up giving large doses of insulin and cause hypoglycemia in pregnancy. Except that metformin has to be stopped when the labor pains start. The last one, sorry, can I just, 1 minute I'll take. 60-year-old type 2 diabetic of 18-year duration, A1C 7.8, suffering from myocardial ischemia and hypertension. He's on human insulin 30, 70 twice a day, 40 and 45 units, BMI 25, occasional hypoglycemia between 5 to 7 p.m. This is typical, this mixture twice a day, which is the most popular regime, unfortunately. You see, this is typical. Okay, how best can you change the treatment? Patient cannot afford treatment with analogs. Patient says, I can't spend for analogs. What will you do? Human regular 3 times a day in the NPH, morning and evening. Human regular 3 times a day, NPH at bedtime. Add A plus A insulin sensitizer, you see. Okay, mix 30-70 at breakfast, at dinner, and regular at lunchtime. Which is the best? B or C? Why not C? Sensitizer. You should use a sensitizer. Type 2 diabetic. Sensitizer is required. Do not attempt to treat a difficult type 2 diabetic with insulin alone. You are doomed to failure. You have to use a sensitizer. That is the key to successful insulin therapy. Keeping multiple doses, small doses, use a sensitizer, that's the key to control without hypoglycemia. So thank you very much for your patient hearing.